Welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast. Here is Mounir Alazouzi from easymedicaldevice.com. And today we will talk about virtual events. So as you may know, because of the pandemic, because of the coronavirus, there was a lot of events that went from face to face to virtual, which is great because, I mean, there is events that are really great and we don't want to miss them. And for that, I have with me the organizers of the Topra Symposium event. So we have Kevin Penn and Raluca, who is helping us to understand exactly how this is working. So Kevin, Raluca, welcome to the Medical Device Made Easy podcast.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mounir. It's really great to be here after following so many of your episodes online.
Thank you. So thank you for accepting the invitation and thank you for the efforts that you are doing here just to educate us on the switch, if I can say, from a face-to-face event to a virtual event. So Kevin, Raluca, maybe just a small introduction of yourself. So Kevin first, maybe.
My name is Kevin Pei. I'm lucky enough to be the chief executive of Topra. This is my first year at the top. A different year, a year that I didn't expect to have to do quite so much experimentation and change. But I have a superb team around me, of which Raluca's part of. So, we're enjoying the challenge. Different ways of doing things, a different world. What more can I say?
I think this is a special year for everybody. So 2020 will be really remembered by everyone, like the year that of the most of the difficulties and challenges. What about you, Raluca?
Definitely.
So my name is Raluca Radu. I'm also quite new in Topra, just since January of last year. So this is actually my second Topra symposium. My role is mainly as regulatory intelligence and symposium manager. So that means that I coordinate the symposium, but my focus is a lot more on the educational side rather than on the logistical side. So we work quite closely with Kevin as well as a team of other colleagues in delivering the symposium.
Yeah, so I remember that last year, I met you last year, I think when I was at the Topra Symposium last year in Ireland. So it was really also a great event. So I think this year you had no choice. There is no possibility now to create like a face-to-face event. So now you switched your Topra Symposium to a virtual event. So can you maybe, you or Kevin, so explain to us how the pandemic helped you to make this quick transition, and how was it difficult for you also to do that?
Well, maybe if I go first, I think that we were very fortunate in that I've got so many regulatory professionals and experts around me that I knew that we were going to have to make this decision. And in fact, we moved out of our offices in London very early on before the UK government decided that you know, it was necessary. So we started looking at other people's platforms and what people were doing, and it highlighted that, you know, there are many advantages going online, but there are also a few pitfalls. So with Raluca's help and the rest of the team, we looked at several other platforms and decided early on that we were going to move onto a digital platform. But Raluca wanted to get all the speakers and the volunteers, and particularly the Belgium agency on side, because Topra can't do these things without the help of so many different institutions and so many different volunteers. So that was really important. But many of the staff went to different virtual events and looked at a whole range of different platforms. I mean, it's amazing. Once you get out there, there's just so many different ways you can do this. And then we actually got quite excited. You know, we thought, well, actually, this is the way to go. You know, we've been talking about doing more digital stuff for years, and this is what we're doing. So Raluca, being the expert on the symposium, I suggested a few different platforms, and you know, she grasped the nettle and went out there and looked at it. So maybe if at this point, you know, Raluca fills in the information I haven't got.
But yeah, I think this point is really interesting, because when you have, if I can say, a normal event, you are looking to an hotel room or a hotel conference place. You are looking for catering. You are looking for all those stuff. So now you have really to switch your mind to look for platforms or for support for IT guys, etc. So Raluca, how was it for you, if I can say, because you have really to make this switch on your mind for that?
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I think that from the two of us, Kevin is probably the technology buff. So he has done a lot of the initial researching of platforms and making sure that it's something which is suitable for us as an organization, and also making sure that it includes as many features as possible for, you know, speakers, but then also delegates and exhibitors, because the Topra Symposium, it's really a whole experience. It's not just a presentation. So I think that, as Kevin mentioned, we were really lucky that we have gotten quite a lot of experience with this, because since March, all our courses have been online, and we've been learning a lot of things about how to best deliver presentations online, how to ensure that the interaction is done in a proper manner. And I think that this has helped us a lot in deciding that we were going to go virtual. We went through different iterations. So we were looking at government advice, and we were thinking maybe we do face-to-face but do a live stream, or maybe we do face-to-face in a socially distanced manner. But I think it became very quickly very obvious that that was not going to be possible. And I think that for us from the beginning, the question was not if we were going to do the event, because I think that the need was still and is still there really to discuss these topics, but how to do it. And we just had to find the ideal solution for us. And luckily we also had a lot of support from our working parties and our speakers and the Belgian agency. It was, I think that this was the thing that amazed me the most, how supportive and how understanding everyone is, because it's really, everybody had to adapt, and it's amazing how fast people have adapted and how we can make use of this technology to really bring people together. This is what excites me the most, I think, about this whole exercise.
No, I think it's great. And as you mentioned, the Topra Symposium is really an experience. I had the chance to participate to that last year, where you have all the exhibitors, where you have all the people that you are meeting there, where you are the speakers who are really giving you some great conferences with some answering your question directly, etc. So was it really, will we really get all this experience, if I can say, within this new mode of creation of a virtual event? Is it something that you see that we will really get this this full interaction with all the people that that we had, if I can say, like last year?
Well, there are a couple of negatives. You will not be enjoying the Topra coffee, and you won't be enjoying the Topra biscuits. But actually, when you distill what we want to achieve and what the agency wants to achieve and our speakers, we can deliver all of that online. And what we're not doing is we're not going for a dead plan presentation. We've invested in a platform. That platform will give us a way of interacting with people on a one-to-one basis, on a one-to-many basis. We'll be able to do videos and downloads, speaker sessions, plenaries, but also for all our supporters, commercial supporters, and there'll be breakout rooms for them, and they'll be able to run surveys. They'll be able to do downloads and videos. So what we basically said to people is, don't think of this as a blocker, but, you know, challenge us. Tell us what you want to do still, and we'll find a way of doing it. And Raluca's very resourceful, as the rest of the team are. And okay, at times they want me to allow things, and I think, I'm not sure we can do that. But in the main, I think the experience will be different, but it will be similar. And the outcomes, and I think that's what the really important thing is, because there's a desperate need for this conference this year, because so many other conferences have been shelved for various reasons. And there's so much going on in the regulatory environment, you know, not just with COVID, but with a load of other things. And I think that, you know, our regulatory professionals, the people out there, whether they be in device, veterinary or big pharma, you know, they're hungry for this event. And that's the feedback we get, because, you know, and I think that, you know, time will tell, but I think it's going to be a superb event. And I think the platform's really flexible.
I think what is also, I mean, as an advantage for people that will participate to that is that they don't have to fly anymore to find an hotel and everything. So it's something that maybe will be great. So to have more people to participate to such event virtually and to enjoy, if I can say, the same types of speakers and same caliber of speakers that you have in normal events. So do you see other advantages, maybe Raluca, do you see other advantages to be, if I can say, coming to this event?
Well, I think that really adding on to your point and adding on to what Kevin was saying, I think that indeed one of the biggest advantages is that people can really do this from the comfort of their own home. And that, you know, means on one side delegates, and that means for them that they don't need to travel, they don't need to pay for a flight, pay for accommodation, travel to a place they might not be very comfortable with, deal with the whole logistics of that. But then that also means that they can integrate the sessions in a normal workday, because that's one of the things that we have done to really adapt the program to normal workdays and ensure that we have enough breaks in between sessions so that people can really dip in and out as they would wish, depending on their interests. And then at the same time, and something that we as Top Rock are also very passionate about is increasing access to our events. So I think that moving digitally is something that we're looking at really for a very long time, and we're taking small steps in doing more of virtual webinars or roundtables and discussion forums. But then this year has really challenged us to move that forward very fast, and I think that really it's this accessibility that makes me very, very excited about it. But then on top of that, you're mentioning speakers that will get the same caliber of speakers. I think that we'll actually get even better speakers, because at least the feedback that we've gotten from contacting people is that they find it way easier to do it from home when they just need to be available for a shorter period of time, when they don't need to travel, maybe, for example, from the US. To come here for a conference, to then go back home. So I think that really we're seeing a lot of very encouraging signals for this type of delivery for our event. And I think that also for others, it's really for all organizations, not only in the pharmaceutical sector, but also in other sectors which have taken this step. I think that the feedback has been very positive in terms of the experience, with of course a few considerations that you need to have in order to do it in a qualitative manner.
Yeah, no, it's clear, and I confirm that I have a lot of other events that are going virtually. I'm invited to some events, for example, in Middle East, Africa, which are also going virtual, and I think it's something, a trend that people will be going through. And as I said, the pandemic really accelerated all this because at the end we had no choice, or it's that, or there will be not a lot of people joining because of this virus that is spreading now. In terms of the program, so as you mentioned, there is pharmaceutical, there is veterinary, and there is medical devices. So last year on medical devices, we had a lot of focus on the EUMDR, which is a new regulation. This year, will there be some focus on some like coronavirus situation, or we continue to have some focus on EUMDR, or there is maybe some surprises there? Or do you have some kind of some short, if I can say, things to say regarding that?
Well, I think that it has been very interesting because I work with pharma, vets, and devices in developing the program. And I think that with the whole coronavirus thing, they've taken very different approaches. So I think that for the medical devices, we won't have a particular session focusing just on this. But then it's obviously embedded in all of the sessions and everybody will consider it. The MDR is, of course, still a focus, but more from the point of view of implications. And then we're moving a lot also to focus on the IVDR. We have two sessions on that. And then we're also really looking at what I think is a really unique position that Opera is in. which is to focus on borderline products as well as combination products. So for that, we have two sessions. And I think that you've had Janine Jamieson last year on the podcast. So she's leading on that. And actually in collaboration with Armin Ritzhaupt from the European Medicines Agency. So that's something that I'm really excited to see. It's also a subject of interest of mine. I find it very fascinating, this whole area, as I think a lot of people do. And I think that in addition to that, we also want to keep things moving forward in a way. So we're also approaching software as a medical device, which is, again, really another hot topic, at least lately. And for a couple of years,
I wanted to ask you that because I know that I got in contact with a lot of customers that are developing software as a medical device, and they want to now be compliant to the EU MDR. And I think, as you mentioned, it's really starting to be a hot topic. So combination products, software development, which is something of interest. So I think, yeah, this will be really following the trend of the, the medical device situation and industry. So I think it's great. So is there, in terms of speakers, as you mentioned, there is bigger caliber of speakers, etc. But where there was directly a buy-in for them to say, yes, I will come, yes, I will join, everything is fine for me, yeah, there is no issue, I can do that. Or there was more like, oh no, I prefer when it's a face-to-face and I will not join because I prefer when there is this networking contact and everything.
Maybe I can answer that. I think that many people were potentially worried about travel. And many pharmaceutical companies in particular have been, you know, very dictatorial, and they will not allow staff to travel.
Okay.
So I think for many people, it was sort of a relief that we've done this. But most people that we've approached about talking have been very, very positive. Because, as I said before, people are hungry to get their message out, to, you know, talk to people and do something that's a little bit, you know, like it normally is. I mean, this our symposium is sort of a calendar event. You know, people look forward to it from one year to the other. I likened it to the Olympics once, but I was shot down. You know, we hand the baton to a new agency and they run with it for us in a new country each year. But I think there's an element of truth in that, you know, and I think that's the excitement around it. And you know, because the support is so great, that's why we can do it. But I don't know, would you say differently, Raluca, or is that what you found as well?
No, I mean, definitely not. I think that we already knew from when we were still looking into doing it physically that we will have some speakers who will only be able to join remotely. So we were also preparing for that at one point. So I think that for a lot of people, it has been a relief. I think that also for us, in a way, the process was that we had to obviously reconfirm everyone because timings have changed slightly. So you need to make sure that people are aware of it, that people are comfortable with it. So that's why we're really in the next period, we will do quite a lot of run-throughs with them to make sure that everybody feels as comfortable as they want. But I think that overall, the general feeling was that of understanding that it's either virtual or it's not at all. And I think that between the choices, I mean, we know what we chose. And I think that's what a lot of people chose, because at the end of the day, there's still a need to discuss these topics. And
What about exhibitors? Because I know that also when I was there last year, there was a lot of people that were exhibiting their services and everything. So how are we now also giving them some advantages or some possibilities to show what they can do or how they can help the people that are participating to the event? Because yeah, before it was like they have those spots or those booths where they are showing with a lot of prospectus, people are going to one to the other to see what they are doing and asking maybe some questions. How they can do that within a virtual event?
Well, there's a number of ways they can do it, and the platform that we've invested in allows for a lot of different ways of interacting. But one of the things we can do is we can have breakout sessions for them and networking sessions and whereby they can invite people in to talk about a particular subject. So we kind of see that, you know, people, I don't know, there might be a company that's, you know, is expert in preparing dossiers. So they might say, you know, we'll have a session for anybody who's interested in software for dossiers. And then they might link that to a survey, and then they might link that to an information stream in the form of a webinar or a video. We've also got a gamification element, so we can do competitions with prizes or competitions with feedback or whatever. And some of the companies that I've spoken to, because my colleague Eric deals with this in the main, but I assist, are really excited by the fact that we'll allow them to have a combination of different ways of communication. And ultimately, if you're at our event and you're a delegate and you want to communicate with one of those companies, on the app or on the virtual platform on a PC, you'll be able to initiate a contact with the salesperson or the representative of that company and have a video link call or a textual chat or whatever. There's no doubt that the companies coming to the event are going to have to work a little bit harder. But is that any bad thing? You know, standing on a stand expecting people to come up to you, it's kind of dead, isn't it? I mean, you know, you've got to get out there. You've got to put your personality out there and get people to come into your stand and engage with you. And so we're offering a whole different range of ways that people can do that. And it's about getting your head around the virtual world. There was at one stage we looked at avatars and we were going to have some sort of 3D thing that you could wander around. But we looked at a couple of systems, and to be honest, a little bit gimmicky, you know, it's the kind of thing that Raluca's right. I'm a bit of a tech buff. I would love, but actually, would it have served any purpose other than Kevin can say I could be an ostrich for the day and wander around the convention? I don't think so. So we're, you know, we've got quality engagement opportunities as sponsors and stand holders, for to use the old term. And it's about their marketing department and their digital people pushing us and challenging us to allow them. I mean, you know, I did suggest at one stage that we could sponsor Raluca's clothing and have different things like the Formula One thing. But apparently that's not allowed. But, you know, apart from that, we'll consider different mechanisms of engaging.
No, I think it's great. I think, yeah, it's really something that will be really new, and I will be really waiting for that, to see that. In terms of the event specifically, so can we remember everybody when it will be live or when it will happen? Because I think there is some different dates per different sections, like medicine, like things. So what are the different dates?
So basically, the whole event, the whole Topra Symposium, that will take place from the 5th to the 8th of October.
Okay.
And then we also have a pre-event day on the 29th of September, where we're organizing some sessions, but maybe more lighter content to get people used to the platform and to make sure that we iron out any challenges that people might have beforehand. And then for the medical device and IVD symposium, that's from the 6th to the 8th of October.
Okay.
So all of this is available on our website in case you want to have a look. It's just toprasymposium.org.
Okay, great. So yeah, if you want to go and check for the program, for the speakers, for also the prices, because there is different prices if you are a member, not a member, etc. So that you can go directly there. Just the last thing, maybe I am participating to the event, so it's like, is it like a full day, like from 8 to 9 in the morning, then 9 to 10 another session, then 10 to 11. Is it like a full day where I have to sit in front of my computer to do things, or there is some breaking session where I can go out and come back and this and that? Is it like that?
So actually what we tried to do, and I think that this was a very good suggestion from our director of professional development, Samantha, was to actually alternate the sessions.
Okay.
So basically we're starting, for example, with a medical device session, and then we have a human symposium session, and then a medical device session. And in those breaks, we're also doing in parallel some networking. which is also hosted by our special interest network. So what we also found was that really, when it comes to online events, in order to promote networking, people are a bit more shy. So you need to really give them a topic to discuss. So we're really making use of all our volunteers to help us with that, which I think is really a great opportunity.
I think it's great. And what I will just miss maybe from those type of events is all the pens and all the small gadgets that I'm getting when I'm coming back from those events with all the marketing things. So it's only the thing that I will be missing. But maybe it's like a reduction of
better for the environment.
What?
Not so much plastic though. Better for the environment.
Exactly, but I think it will be great for the nature then. Okay, so great. I think we covered really all the information that we wanted to speak about the event. So please go to the Topra Symposium website so that you can get that. And you can get anywhere that on the show notes. So to look at that. So do you have some last words, if I can say, to say about maybe Topra Symposium or the situation, the current situation?
Well, I'd just say that, we would never have wished this on the world, but, we're hoping that lots of positive things will eventually come out of it. And I think the movement, to put more digital stuff out there will reunite globally the regulatory world in a different way. And, I'm delighted that last year we had two members attended from India. This year, we've already got interest from 60 plus people coming. And so I think, there are a lot of downsides. And I know I was a bit flippant about, there will be no biscuits and coffee. And it will be different, but I think it's going to be different in a really good way and a very engaging way. And I have to say, I'm delighted with the way the agencies responded, with the way my teams responded, with the way the volunteers have responded. And latterly, there's a lot of interest with our commercial and sponsors as well. So I think it's going to be a really good event. I'll be sitting there, and there's lots of breaks, and I'm one of these people that, if I'm on a meeting for more than an hour, I start to doze off. So Raluca's kindly given me lots of rest. So it's going to be really good.
Great. 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 So I really thank you for all that. And I will be really trying to enjoy this event. And I will try also to post maybe some small videos of the event so that people can see how it is from the inside, if I can say. So for the people that are listening to this episode, so don't forget to go to the show notes so that they can get all the links so that you can also participate to the event. Don't also forget to provide a review or comments for this episode. And if you have any question to Kevin or Raluca, don't hesitate to provide that on the comments. I will be sending that to them so that they can answer to you. Okay, so great. So thank you, Raluca. Thank you, Kevin. Really happy to be part of this this Topra Symposium with you. And I will be looking at this from my my couch or my my desk chair. And I hope really I will be enjoying that. So thank you really, and I wish you a nice day.
Thank you very much, Monir, and thank you all for listening. And if you have any questions, we'd be always happy to have a chat.
Great.
Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you.